Gut 1,5 Autostunden von Louisville, Kentucky entfernt, liegt mitten im Nirgendwo die Maker's Mark Distillery. Eingebettet in eine Landschaft, die an unsere Breiten erinnert, aber mit einem Sommerklima, das man mit subtropisch am besten umschreiben könnte. Wir haben die Brennerei, die sich fast wie ein Museumsdorf präsentiert, gemeinsam mit Bill Santori, dem österreichischen Händler Del Fabro und Mitgliedern der Vienna Bar Community besucht, um dort mehr über sie zu erfahren und ein besonderes Fass für die Wiener Bar-Szene zu kreieren und abzufüllen. Doch zunächst geht es einmal vorbei an historischen Gebäuden der Starhill Farm, wo die 1889 gegründete Brennerei seit 1958 ihren Maker's Mark produziert, hin zum Besucherzentrum. Machen wir einmal einen kleinen Rundgang durch die Räume, in denen man die Touren buchen kann. Im Besucherzentrum sind auch die aktuellen Abfüllungen der Brennerei ausgestellt. Und einige Special Releases, die auch zu Charity-Zwecken ausgegeben wurden. Das hier sind die Counterfeits der bisherigen Besitzer und Master Distiller aus der Samuels-Familie. Jetzt aber geht es in die historische Brennerei. Hier sind die Stills, in denen der Low Wine und High Wine destilliert werden. Daneben finden wir die Mühle für das Getreide. Bei gut 40 Grad erklärt uns der Guide den Vorgang des Einmeischens des weizenlastigen Bourbons.
When we're ready to start cooking, we have 3 mash tubs here at Maker's Mark. Mash number 1, mash number 2, number 3 is in the back room. When we're mashing, we're adding all of our grains separately at different temperatures. Not only to maximize the flavor, but to slowly convert all those starches into fermentable sugars. Once we've added those grains, we also add sour mash to this as well. It's going to help us with taste consistency and also for pH. We use a very acidic mash, which provides a very perfect environment for our yeast strain that we use during the fermentation. So, our mash is going to cook at a very slow, low temperature, 3 to 4 hours. It's like a good stew. The longer and slower you cook it, the more mouth-watering, full flavor will be. So likewise, our mash is going to smell and taste a lot like a cornbread, a whole wheat bread, a really, really sweet cereal. At that point, ready to ferment, we'll chill the mash down to about bath water temperature. We'll pump it next door where it's going to ferment for 3 full days. Here at Makers, we use a 3-day all-natural fermentation process. But also in order to ferment, you have to add yeast. In 1953, Bill and Margie brought the yeast strain here with them, and we still propagate that same yeast strain here every single day. So we're going to go upstairs. We're going to talk about that yeast strain. We're going to talk about how we propagate it. We're also going to taste some of the yeast as well. And we'll be back down here in a little while to taste off the still.
Dann geht es aus dem Stillroom einen Stock höher, wo wir mehr über die Rolle der Hefe erfahren.
In 1953, Bill and Margie Samuels brought a yeast strain here with them, and we still propagate that same yeast strain every single day, right? I want you to think of the yeast as a bridge between the flavors in your grains and the flavors in your whiskey. If that bridge was ever torn down, it will change the flavor of our whiskey. So what we're propagating is the one and only strain that we use, and we've been making it over and over and over since 1950s. This is our yeast strain. It's not your typical store-bought powdered yeast. It's hydrated. Helps us build that flavor profile early. If you feel that little draft of 40-degree air coming out of there, it feels really good. So it's what we call a jug yeast. This comes directly from our mother strain, the larger jugs you see there in the back. The purest forms of the yeast that we have, and we keep our mother strains stored in several locations around the world so we don't cross-contaminate them. And also, the one thing that you necessarily can't recreate is the yeast strain. You know, if this place ever blew over, we can rebuild the still house, we can get more stills, we can get more mashed up, we can get more grains. You can't get more yeast. So every single batch that we do, we also test it thoroughly to make sure that it is consistent. So how this starts, we have our jugs there, those come directly from our mother strains. We'll dump those into little buckets and start this propagation process. We'll then add the buckets to a machine in the next room called a donut. It's a 200-gallon stainless steel tank with an agitator in the middle. We add water from our lake, we add yeast food, we also add Cascade hops. Now the Cascade hops, like a juice, like we use for beer making, like barley hops. I'll close the store here. The hops do a couple of things. Number one, they're a preservative, but they're also loaded with enzymes. Yeast loves to eat enzymes. So, feed the yeast, it gets really, really happy, and it reproduces over and over and over and over. This process goes on for about 24 hours. After that 24-hour period, we'll pump that yeast downstairs to a day yeast tank. At this point, we're gonna give it some of our malted barley, so we'll get loaded with enzymes. We're also gonna give it some of our soft red winter wheat. So at this point, not only are we growing the yeast, we're also training the yeast on what it's gonna be feeding on when we enter it into our mash tubs. The entire process of making our yeast takes about 2 full days. After that 2-day period, we chill it back down to 40 degrees. Anybody know why we do that? Yeast is a living organism. Like all living organisms, they can mutate, they can change, they can die off, they can speed up. So we chill it back down. It makes those cells essentially slow way down and go dormant. When we add that yeast to our mash, the temperature brings it back up, and it slowly starts to ferment all those sugars in the alcohol. You want to taste some of it?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not bad, I promise. You take a smell. Take a little sip. It's a little chunky, so I'll let you know ahead of time. So in the yeast, you're gonna get a lot of the hops flavors. This is just what we pull off with the donut.
It smells verdammt. Wir haben mischen aus Bier und Joghurt. Like between beer and yogurt something?
Yeah.
Yeah. With like the Kohlensäure. Yeah.
Tastes like a really, really sweet like IPA, right?
Yeah.
Selfie down hops.
Den nehme ich schon.
So when you taste it, what flavors did you get on the palate besides like the beer taste? Okay, sweet, sour, dry?
It's sour.
A little bit sour, okay. Karen?
Thank you.
Like beer and dip your finger in there, take a little time?
I don't like beer and I don't look like your work, so
it's not gluten-free.
So...
Is it gluten-free, actually? No. No, yeah.
No. Oh, no. Yeah. It's not gluten-free. It's a little working anyway. Sorry. Yeah, it's definitely
got it. I can't wait to say thank you.
Anyways, those flavors you mentioned are really prevalent in our yeast strain. So orange peel, fruit, sour notes, sweet notes, bread notes, all those are prevalent. Once we add our wheat to this, downstairs in the donut tank, it would taste identical to a Hefe or a Blue Moon side by side. Very sweet. Very light, very crisp on the palate. A lot of those same flavors we'll also see in our whiskey.
Unser Guide führt uns wieder zurück nach unten. Am Eingang vorbei und dann in einen Nebenraum, in dem sich die Maisbottiche befinden.
So welcome to our fermentation. In this room is just our 8 original fermenters. 12 feet deep, 12 feet wide, they're made of all natural cycles. Some of the lumber on these fermenters were installed in 1889. Not only are they very old, like they always say, if it's not broken, it's broken. So, once a batch is finished cooking, it will stay in one fermenter for the whole 3-day process. On that first day, we had the yeast we tasted upstairs, and because that batch is filled with sugar, the yeast is very active, creates very heavy bubbles. It's kind of see this here. This is not oil. It's actually carbon dioxide being released from yeast. If you ever make a yeast roll, it's the exact same thing that makes a yeast roll rise. This is a day one. Take a feel of it. It's actually cold to touch. Take a little taste.
Much sweet.
Very, very sweet, right? Kind of tastes like a sweet bread or sweet syrup. As we ferment, we're going to pick up more sour smells and flavors as we're going. We're slowly gaining alcohol. We're also losing sugar. Also, we're going to see a cap form on top as well. You can see that here in the middle. The cap is basically grains that are rising to the top, locking in the alcohol content of the batch.
Let's taste a
This is a day two here. So this is a day two of fermentation. You'll notice it's still got a pretty consistent bubble to it, but it's getting warmer. Take a smell of it.
You smell the alcohol.
Smell the alcohol. You also get some of those sour notes, right?
Yeah.
The second day is where you get the majority of your alcohol production. Take a taste of it. It's warmer. Yeast is producing heat.
And thicker. Right.
A bit thicker on top.
Much more sour.
Tastes almost like a sweet sour beer, right? By the time we get to that third and final day of fermentation, the cap on this will grow to about 8 inches thick. Let's see if we can find one that's closer to a day three.
Noch einmal werfen wir einen Blick auf die Stills, um dann zur Abfüllanlage zu gehen.
Alright, so before we go in the bottling house, I'm going to explain the process. It's kind of noisy in there. Here at Maker's Mark, we produce 65,000 bottles a day. We have two bottling lines. The line that we're going to see is the B line. It does any size or product that we make at the rate of 3,000 to 4,000 bottles an hour, with up to 6 dippers. Our A line, the opposite of the building, only does the standard bourbon in fits. They also have 6 dippers. They can do between 5,000 and 6,000 bottles. Okay? The most iconic part of the Maker's Mark bottle is that red wax coming down the neck, right? Not only does that wax seal the bottle, but those drips add personality. No two bottles are the same. That's because every single bottle is hand-dipped in wax. If both of our bottling lines are going full steam, our 12 dippers can dip 23 bottles a minute per person. Yep. Come on in, show you how we do it.
Natürlich darf der Besuch in einem der Warehouses nicht fehlen. Die meisten davon sind nicht am Gelände der Brennerei und öffentlich nicht zugänglich. Bond Warehouse A ist das kleinste und älteste, wie unser Guide in ihm erzählt.
So, welcome to Bond Warehouse A. This is actually our oldest and smallest warehouse here at the distillery. As I mentioned a couple times, it only holds like 4,000 barrels. It's not very big. Our larger warehouses hold 50,000 barrels. Even between the two, big or small, the exact same aging process. Number one, they're all natural climate. So relatively cooler on the lower floors, like a basement or like your cellar would be at your home. Really, really hot on the top floors and the attics, like your house would be as well. It's very, very hot. So All of our barrels age the exact same way for 6 to 6.5 years, by taste and not by time. They're made by independent stave company, Kentucky Cooperage. It's 15 minutes down the road in Lebanon, Kentucky. Make all of our barrels out of American white oak that have been seasoned, charred, and built specifically for our taste profile. What they're called premium barrels. Once they build those, they ship them to us. We'll hand inspect every single barrel. We'll then fill it with 53 gallons of our grain alcohol. Now the high wine that we tasted was 130 proof. Legally, we can't barrel it any higher than 125 proof. So what we'll do is we'll actually add water to it, and we'll bring the proof down to 110 proof. We do that because that little extra bit of water content helps us retain the softer, lighter, rounder flavors in the oak. So, we'll fill the barrels up, 53 gallons at a time, 110 proof, and those new barrels will be shipped to a warehouse like you see here. When they get here, they're gonna spend their first 3 years on the very top floors. So up there, it stays very, very hot. Day like today, it's probably 130, 140 degrees. That heat provides a very aggressive aging process. You get a lot of that initial color into bourbon, and also the wood of the barrel expands. When it does, it releases rich alcohol and water vapors from inside the barrel, known as the angel shares. But as those vapors go through the wood, they also extract natural caramelized sugar. It's just behind the char line, okay? So the alcohol essentially penetrates the wood and starts to draw out that those natural flavors.
How high is the angel share in percentage per year?
We lose about 25% over the full aging process of our whiskey.
Over 6 years.
Over 6 years, okay.
Most of that's gonna be in your first 3 years, between 15 and 20%. After the first 3 years of being in the hot climate, we pull those barrels down, pop the bung out, take a little taste. We'll then rotate the three-year-old barrels to the lower floors. So down here, not only does it stay cool year-round because of the damp air settling, but some of that ground temperature rising as well. All these barrels surrounding us were on their last couple years of aging. So down here, because it stays cooler year-round, they'll stay here for the remaining portion of their aging process. The cooler climate's gonna make the wood of the barrel really, really tight, and it will squeeze all that rich flavor in the oak back into the bourbon. So over a 6 to 7 year aging period, your barrel is going to expand and contract multiple times, balancing flavors between your grain alcohol and the wood of your barrel. Every single barrel that we have ages the exact same way. 3 years upstairs, 3 to 3.5 downstairs by taste and not by time. Once they're finished, we small batch everything. We'll take 378 barrels and we marry those together to create one bourbon. However, that alcohol has been test tasted a minimum of 6 times, from the time it came off of the still to the time it goes into the bottle. Not only test tasting for perfection, so that every single bottle we make tastes exactly like that very first bottle that was ever made. Standard 90 proof Maker's Mark bourbon is nearly 90% of what we produce. And we ship it to nearly 50 different countries around the world. Pretty cool. Then finally, once we're done with our barrels, most of them go to Lafroy in Scotland to use for their scotch.
Question.
Yeah.
How does it happen that the alcohol strength can increase upstairs in the highest floors?
So on the higher floors, you're losing water at a pretty rapid rate compared to alcohol. So it will actually make that proof jump up. Downstairs, because the water molecules are larger and that wood tightens up, you'll still lose alcohol vapor, but you will retain water. So it will make your proof go down.
So that's because the barrel opens up, mm-hmm. So the water can evaporate.
Yep.
Right, thank you.
Water and alcohol both.
Yeah. How long does it take to change the barrels from up to down?
Move them.
We move them all by hand. We've got a couple big crews that they're actually getting ready to start rotation season here in the next week or so. They'll rotate 95,000 barrels in about 8 weeks. That's from top to bottom. And then we're dumping about 650 barrels a day. We're filling about 800 barrels a day.
Das war der offizielle Teil der Führung. Wir sehen uns noch etwas auf dem Gelände um. Die Brennerei ist Teil des Kentucky Bourbon Trails und perfekt für Besucher gestylt. Man hat eher den Eindruck, in einem Vergnügungspark zu sein, als in einer funktionalen Anlage. Und dann kommen wir zu dem Teil unseres Besuches, in dem Arbeit von uns verlangt ist. Die Komposition eines Single Barrels für die Vienna Bar Community. Komposition deshalb, weil Maker's Mark ja Wert darauf legt, dass jedes Fass gleich schmeckt. Wie kann man also da etwas Einzigartiges machen? Man stellt eine Nachreifung aus Staves zusammen, anhand eines interessanten Prozesses. Man beginnt mit einem Maker's Mark Cask Strength als Grundlage und wählt dann aus 5 verschiedenen Staves aus. Baked American Pure 2, Seared French Cuvée, Maker's 46, Roasted French Mocha und schließlich Toasted French Spice. Nun gilt es, 10 Staves aus dem Sortiment zu einer Einzelfassabfüllung zusammenzustellen, mit Hilfe dieser Boards in der Mitte des Tisches, die als Erinnerungsstütze verwendet werden. Man probiert, verändert, mischt, probiert wieder und kommt nach einigen Runden zu einem Ergebnis. Eines von über 1000 möglichen übrigens. Und mit diesem Ergebnis geht man dann in die Fassbinderei, wo ein Fass Maker's Mark Cask Strength, das zuvor geleert wurde, geöffnet wird. In dieses kommen dann die zuvor ausgesuchten Staves.
We need 5 Cuvées. We'll grab 5 of those. We need 3 46s. And we need 2 Moses.
So, such in yours.
So, 12 on the top, right? Okay, so we're going to put them on one at a time. Just put them on the ring here. They'll put a space in between. And then we'll drop them. They'll have to go in and sit forward.
It's like a ring.
Put on this one. You got to put a space in between. Dude! Literally perfectly accepted.
Take a picture.
Wenn die Staves im Fass sind, wird es wieder verschlossen und dann mit dem zuvor entnommenen Maker's Mark befüllt. Es ruht dann 9 Wochen lang zur Nachreifung in diesem Keller, bevor es abgefüllt wird. Und damit endet unser Tag bei Maker's Mark, der Bilderbuch-Brennerei mitten im Herzen des Bourbon Countries. Es war uns ein Vergnügen. Cheers und auf Wiedersehen.